So I have been working with the pediatric population, mainly five and under, for over 30 years. So now you guys know how old I am. And I have three of my own grown kids now. My youngest is 18 and graduating from high school. So I have three girls. So I know all about language development from a parent perspective. Plus, my middle child has cerebral palsy and epilepsy and learning disabilities. So I also know the parent perspective from that angle as well, you know, going through the special ed system in school and now being a parent of a young adult with special needs. So it's an interesting journey for life. And I know there are some of us here that have students with IEPs and there are some that don't. So I'll try to talk kind of over the whole spectrum of language. But I am not a PowerPoint person, and so I did not do a PowerPoint. I am a hands-on person. And so my thought process today was just to bring all of the things that your kids are playing with, not all of them, because it would fill the room, and kind of show you how we use it in school and how you can use it home and expand those language skills, and not just language, but articulation as well and social skills. Because at this age, it's all one big happy mess. So it's a good way to do it. The first couple of things I did want to talk about, though, are some of the things that a lot of the things that I do here that you actually can do in your home, and you probably already are doing, and you don't realize that those are some strategies that I use to work on language and articulation skills. So I'll use some fancy words, but then when we talk about it, you'll understand what I mean. So we use a lot of communication temptations. So these are things that your children like. But we devise ways to make them less accessible so that children have to request that for them. And so I want you to think, too, about your own child while I'm talking. So that way, if you have questions, later on, I'm going to ask you all for your email, or actually, I'm going to probably give you mine, and I want you to email me those questions so that I can kind of answer you guys directly. But communication temptations. Did I not?
No. Did we?
Okay. For everybody else. Yeah, yeah. Sure.
Just
sure.
Your child's name and what class they're in. Sorry, Mary.
I know who you guys are, so that's why.
I don't know if they know each other.
Hi, I'm Kara Nath. We're actually very new to the area. My son Rishi joined Frog Classroom in January.
I'm Carrie Redden. My son Luke is in the Turtle
Classroom. Amazing.
We're pretty new as well since September.
Robert Hux, our son Logan is in Frog as well. We've been here for a long time.
September.
Well, Falls Church, the area, okay. For like 10 years.
I'm Jenny. With him.
I'm Emily, and my son Harley, I don't know which.
He's a frog.
He's a frog too, okay.
Oh, it's a frog.
we've been in Falls Church since October, and he's been in school since February. So.
So all of you have the young kids. Your kids are what we consider the young kids. So I'll kind of speak to that then most of the time today. Just because it's easier and it's much more applicable to you all. But communication temptations basically mean putting things out of reach. So I'm going to show you kind of how we do that. Most of your kids can't open this up. If they can, get one of the screw cap ones. But putting things in containers or in bags. You know, they can see it, but most likely they can't get it out. And the reason why that you do that is because you want your child to request. And requesting doesn't necessarily mean, hey, mom, can you open this? Because if that was happening, they wouldn't be seeing me. But requesting can be handing it to you, pointing at it, trying to find it, maybe making a word approximation for what it is. So you as the parent, you get the bag, and then you do the next thing, the next type of communication temptation. You say, yeah, I got the Play-Doh. I like Play-Doh. Man, I can't wait to play with the Play-Doh. And hopefully they'll do something, you know. Try to get it open, give it back to you. And that's when you'll say, you know, give them some prompts. You know, open the bag or open it. And that also, too, depends on, like, where your child is, which I'm sure most of you know. Some of your children may be on a single word level. Some of your children might be on a sentence level. So you just want to expand wherever that level is that they're at. So I don't want to use the word withholding, but keeping things that you know that a child desires or their favorite things, keeping them up high so that they have to give you some kind of a communication to get it, keeping them in a box or a bin, maybe with a picture on it so that they can pull the picture off that bin and bring it to you, keeping them in bags, in containers like this, so that they're having to work harder to get you to do what it is that they want with that piece. Not to mention the fact it works on fine motor skills, because you can also practice those as well. So those are some of the things that I do quite a bit. If I had my perfect speech room, would be a room with those kind of cabinets like we have, completely floor to ceiling with pictures on them, so that the kids would have to go grab a picture and give it to me so that I know what they want. Because that is a type of communication. And for kids that don't have a lot of language skills and don't have a lot of words, it's perfect. What I do a lot with some of the older kids and with kids that have more language is we get a game. And then I say, oh, I forgot how to play this game. Do you guys remember how to play it? Generates lots of language that way. Maybe somebody's remembered one step and somebody's remembered another step. But maybe that first step was the second step, so I'm trying to figure out how it is that this all works together. So with older kids, you can use that to work with sequencing, you know, information, you know, what happens first, what happens next, what happens last. So just forgetting. I mean, you can do that, too, with putting coats on. Oh, I forgot how to put my coat on or my boots on. And have your kid tell you those kinds of things. So that's a little bit of a higher level step for students who have more language skills. Some of your kids might have two-word sentences. So the idea is to get into 3 to 4-word sentences. So how do you do that? You know, your student says, or your kid says, me Play-Doh. Oh, you want Play-Doh. I want Play-Doh. So you give them that model. I wouldn't expect them to say it immediately, but you just keep giving them those models. The more they hear, the more they'll start to pick up. You also want to look at where they are. If they're at 2 words, you really only want to do maybe 3 or 4. If they're at 2 words, you really don't want to do 10, because they're going to get lost. And it's just going to be frustrating for both of you. The other good thing to think about is narrating play. So I do this a lot with my kids I work with. I really try to, though, go where they are. So if they're in a 2-word phrase or a 1-word phrase or no words, I'm going to narrate at 2 to 3 words. Like, go car, go fast, down the ramp, or push it, those kinds of things. To keep it short so that, and at their level of understanding, that's what's really important. And this is something that you can do in all instances. When I go and I pick up a child from their room, we're walking down the stairs because I'm down here and a lot of them are upstairs. We're continually down we go, down we go, down we go, and then up we go, up we go, up we go. What do? You're right in their face saying, great, you know, love you, love you, love you. And that's a form of communication. So nonverbal communication is really important. And your students are really doing that all the time. And when kids are screaming, protesting, screaming, that's a form of communication. So it's important that, you know, at that point we say, you're mad. You don't want to do this. You're praising that communication, even though it's not, it'll drive you crazy. You're still praising it because it's important that they do that as well. So I wanted to bring some toys with you and show you a little bit how I use them. And I have up here some things that I've given to each of the teachers to have them think about what they're doing in the classroom and expand on that. So I'm going to pass these around so that you can look at them and the other ones. But basically, it gives you like action words that you can use, description words that you can use, play and social skills, and expanding vocabulary with things like dress-ups, instruments, dolls, blocks, books. So I love these, and some of the teachers you'll notice might have them in their classrooms. It's also a great thing for, they use them a lot with substitutes, because we have substitutes that come in and they're not quite sure what the students are working on. But it's a good, it's a good way for substitutes to think, okay, that's what we need to do, and teachers to say, oh, that's what I can work on here. So I love these little action, or these little language builders, and I'm happy to email them to you all if you want them, okay? They're really nice. So let me show you, because I was going to tell you, this is it. This is the one that I can usually get any kid to respond to, is bubbles. And, you know, when I have students, kids that come in and I'm doing evaluations and I can't get anything out, this will do it. So in terms of language and language expansion and concepts that you can teach with bubbles, you know, besides just the word bubble, you've got up, down, because you can blow your bubbles up, you can blow your bubbles down. You have body parts, you can blow your bubbles on your feet, you can blow your bubbles on your nose. You have clothes, you can blow your bubbles on your shoes, on your pants, on your shirt. You have pop. You have stamp, because you can stamp on all the bubbles. You have clap, because you can clap bubbles. You have eat, because you can eat bubbles. You know, you try to catch them with your mouth. So there's so many, many, many different kinds of concepts that can be taught with just this little, easy, simple, and quite basic, frankly, cheap toy. You can also make your own bubbles, which is a whole nother thing. But Logan did?
Like bubbles with his mouth.
Bubbles with your own. Bubbles with your own spit, why not, right? It's great. Yeah. This, yeah. And if you have an older child and you have a younger child and your younger child is the child that you really want to work with language, have the older child blow bubbles with the younger one. And then you've got a three-way there, or you've got two-way, and you can be facilitating my turn with the child that needs that kind of work. A lot of times, these are some of the pictures that I use. So you can see just here, a student that a child may not have a lot of words can indicate, you know, bubbles, blow bubbles, open, more, all done, in, out, and if you've got one with the lid on, off. So there's a lot of concepts and a lot of things that you can teach with bubbles. It's one of my absolute favorite ones, and it's probably the first, when I'm working with a student with pictures, it's probably the first one they choose all the time. That's the first one we get consistently, is bubbles. So I love these. My second favorite, potato head. There's so many ways to use potato head. You got body parts, you got clothes, you got colors, You have different kinds of body parts. You might have eyes that are black and eyes that are blue and eyes that have big eyelashes on them. So there's a lot of different ways, if your child is already using a lot of concepts, to add to that. You've got arms and hats. And generally, when I'm using the potato head, my potato heads are in a bag or in a container. So of course, when we have to work on getting the top off of the container and getting the potato heads out that we want, they have nothing on them. And I have, and these are easy for you to do at home now with all the technology. When I first started, we didn't have all of the technology, so we did a lot of our own things. We had the old cameras that you could, the pictures would come right out of. Yeah. So you can take, you know, pictures of the different parts and have them out there, you know, one at a time so that they can put those different, show you which part they want and put it on.
There are also big and little.
There's big and little, yes. There are big, now there are big, little, and giant potato heads. And think about, too, if you've got those big, little, and giant potato heads, you're also working on that concept. And they're really hard. Some of them are really hard to get them in there. So here's your, trying to get it in there and they can't. What are they going to do? Somehow they're going to indicate that they need help doing it. If they're not indicating that they need help, then as a parent, you're going to say, not can I help you, but help, help, you know, help, I need help, put it on. Hopefully you're going to get some kind of a response for that. The other thing that I'll do is it'll be my turn to make the potato head. Sometimes I actually make the potato head first because that desire to do it gets stronger and stronger. And then I might get some kids going, my turn, which is perfect. I will be like looking at my pictures going, I don't know what to pick. Do I want the eyes or the nose? The eyes or the nose? And most of the time, somebody, you know, one of the children will grab the eyes and give it to me. That's what they want me to put. Oh, okay, I'll put the eyes on. So that's another way of using potato head, not just having your child build one, but you build it and have them tell you what to put on as well. I've also done activities where I have two students working together, and there, one of them is making the potato head and requesting the pieces from the other one, who has a big, giant box, and they've got to go through the box and find the pieces. A lot of times I've done that with students. The higher level student may have the be requesting, and a student who doesn't have a lot of language, I'm helping them find that piece and giving it to them. So that's a lot of back and forth between peers, which is really what we want ultimately for our kids, is that back and forth interaction between their peers.
Mary mentioned something that I don't know if everyone picked up on, but if she's using the pictures with a kid, it's not just the kid using them to request, it's Mary using the picture and modeling that requesting with it as well.
Yeah, it's important because those are just different ways to teach
those kinds of skills. Well, sorry, but everybody, this is the other one that's everyone's favorite. And because it's in the cars are in a container and they can't get the container off, they're going to try everything they can to get that container off or to get you to get it off for them. So it's another great way for it to work on requesting, to work on asking for help. And then if your child is older and you're teaching colors, you've got different colors to ask for colors. What I will do with these is generally I'll try to get one car at a time, and as it comes off the bottom, I'm trying to get it. A couple times I'll let my kids I'm working with get it, or I'll grab it so that they have to continue to request. I mean, quite frankly, I can work with a student with this for a half an hour, with this for a half an hour, and with this for a half an hour. And the nice thing is, it's, you know, you're doing the same thing over again, but that repetition and that modeling is really what they need.
Taking just one car out for the kids who have more language or who are able, you know, they have more skills, and then they're playing with a peer, and they have to figure out that social negotiation mm-hmm. of how to negotiate who gets the car when and which color are we going to choose, and all that kind of stuff is also really.
And if they both want the same color, how are they going to figure that one out?
Mm-hmm. So taking a step back and letting them use their words to figure that out.
30 minutes this morning.
So one of the way, so let me tell you how I deal with that, because that's a, they're both wanting green, and you know we're starting to get into that. I want green. I'll be like, oh man. And I usually have, I'll show you how to do it. Oh my gosh, you both want green. What are we going to do? And usually that stops them. You want green and you want green. What are we going to do? Maybe we, and we start to talk about that. What can we do? You know, maybe you can use it now and you can use it when they're finished. You know, maybe you can say not now, in a minute. Some of your kids might come home a lot and start saying in a minute, because that's what we all say, in a minute. So it's a great negotiating tool. Same with any of these. The telephone. So, you know, I'm sorry, but I like these. I don't like the kind of pretend cell phones. And because you're also working on other skills, fine motor skills, okay, when you do it this way. And there is nothing better than a telephone with kids. We have two of these. And we just call each other. I mean, we can also do this for a half an hour. Just call each other. Hi, Mom. Want to talk to Sam? It's your turn. Yeah. And it's great. With a child who doesn't have a lot of language, even if they pick up the phone and go, babble, 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 that's perfect. Imitate what they're doing. Or they pick up the phone and you pick up the phone and go, mama, mama, baba, and see if you can get those kinds of imitations going. With older students or students that have more language, each of them get a phone and see what kind of conversation that they can have with each other. If you have your child at home who's working on language skills, and your older child or the babysitter or the nanny, pretend phone play. It's really great. It's a great way to do it. You can practice calling grandma, practice calling grandma, practice calling grandma, and then call grandma and see if those skills have gone.
Or we have a phone in like the toy kitchen. He's always calling grandma.
I walked into one of the older classrooms yesterday, and they found that they had a matching walkie-talkie. So we had a whole walkie-talkie conversation. it was hysterical, and they had a lot of language. So we had a very in-depth conversation.
That's what's so, and we'll talk a little bit too in a minute about other. I should have brought in the other thing I had, but we can talk about that. Nah, it's just a box. Shopping cart or baby stroller. I mean, this can be a baby stroller. This can be whatever you want it. This can be this can be a dump truck if you want it to be. It can be whatever you want it to be. such a great thing for kids. So one of the things that because I was thinking about this, one of the things that we have a student here who takes a shopping cart around and picks up the milk from all the classes. And I was thinking about that and uses a augmentative communication device to do that. So I was thinking about that. I was thinking, how could you do that at home? Oh my gosh, think about that. When you have people that come and visit, you know, and it's snack time, put the snack in the cart and your kid can walk around everybody and say, you know, want a snack, or just, even if they don't have words, just giving somebody that item is communication. Pick up, clean up. Clean up is so hard. I don't know about you guys, but it was very hard for my kids to clean up. What I found is if we threw everything in like the shopping cart or the baby stroller, they were just really gung-ho'd to walk around and put things away. Which actually also works on categorization if you have items kind of organized. So, you know, you've got all your little people in a box and all your cars in a box. So that's working on categorization, which is a great thing to work on with kids. So a shopping cart or a baby stroller is a great thing. You're also working on gross motor skills, and you're pushing, and some of our students need a lot of input in terms of sensory input, so that's a perfect thing to do. You're on your way outside and you want to take balls with you, throw them in the shopping cart, throw them in the baby stroller. It's a great way to work on that. That's what I didn't bring. In our room is a big ball that, you know, you'll see it with the ball tent. I mean, you'll see when you go in there, it's full of balls.
Oh. Okay.
You can't miss it. It's got the troll thing on from the troll movie.
I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah. Shape sorters. This is an old shape sorter. It's a little bit of a boring one. There's actually newer ones out that are really nice. In, out, open, help, all kinds of words that you can get out of this. And with your older students, with the kids here that are older, you know, shapes, just the shape. Quite frankly, some of these shapes, I can't remember what the names are because I'm a preschooler. So, but fantastic toy. Not just for language, but for fine motor skills as well. So a great way to incorporate all of those things together. Colors. You'll notice that these are all blue and red, so somebody must have been working on blue and red with this one. So you can just do colors if you wanted to. Also, this one is a little hard to get open because the kids can't figure out what side opens it. So I'll always put the open side here on the bottom. So they have to try to figure it out. And a lot of kids, you know, are working kind of on their own problem-solving skills. Some of them will just give it up. So it's teaching them that, you know, they can problem-solve. That means you got to pick it up. You got to turn it around. Oh, does this one work? No. Which one works? Let's find it. So that's that narration at the same time, narrating it. Oh, my goodness, can we find it? There it is. We got it open. So kind of manipulating some of the things that you already have at home to make that language come out. I'll just do the balls since they're here. So you don't have to do this with your balls. You could put them in someplace else. But you'll notice in this tent, we have all different colors and shapes and textures and I don't think the hard one's in here, but some of them are really hard and some of them are really squishy. So you've got squishy and hard. You got bumpy. You got pointy. You got gray or silver, which is not a color that kids kind of think about a lot. You've got big and you have got teeny. So lots of different words. Great way to work on not just expressive language, but following directions. Hey, go get that big ball. Go get the smallest one you can find. If your student is not real verbal, take some pictures of your different balls and hand them that picture to go get. Because they're having to use some of those visual discrimination skills and problem-solving skills, trying to figure out how to get it out. So we, in the therapy room with OTPT and me, we tend to keep the balls like that. So that we can work on all different kinds of activities. And this is great because then you're going to dump them in through here.
Or you can add two adjectives if your kid has more language or is working on two-step things.
The bumpy silver ball, you know. Not the bumpy pink ball, the bumpy silver ball. So this is another great way. And you guys have, I know you have a lot of things like this at your house. So just kind of think about how you can use what you have at home to increase that communication level. Okay, this is also my favorite. The cardboard blocks. I love the big ones. We have some smaller ones here, but one of the reasons why I love the big ones is because the little kids, it's so much easier for them to pick them up, but it just requires more effort on their part as well. We keep them in here because it has a zipper on it. So why do you think we keep them in here? Yeah, they have to get it open somehow. All right. And if they don't know what's in here, then they're, so for some of the older kids that have more language, they're feeling, oh my goodness, that must be an edge. Feel that. It's must be an edge of something in there. Yeah. And then we open it up, and we've got we've got colors. We've got big red ones, and we've got little yellow ones, and we've got kind of medium-sized blue ones. So there's more attributes and more descriptors to use. So when you build blocks with kids, what inevitably happens? I love it. So when kids knock them over, you know, Miss Mary's like, yay, wonderful. Somebody else is not happy because they got theirs knocked over. So we work it out. Uh-oh, what can you say? You know, no blocks over. What can you say? Yeah, sorry. I have to tell you, I don't really, and when a child has more language, I work more on some of those politeness markers. When they don't have a lot of language, you know, to me, I just want to get no block over or no, and I'm fine with that. Building is great in terms of language expansion. You know, block on, block on, block on, block on, knock it down. Block on, block on, block on, block on, knock it down over and over again. I don't know about you guys, but some of the kids here will do we could spend another half an hour just doing blocks. It's such a great activity. Once again, an older child in your house and your younger child, your older child can tell your younger child which ones to get. Go get the blue one, go get the red one, put them on top. Okay, ready, set, go, let's knock them down. Or if it's your older child that's working on language and your younger child has some more language, you can work with your younger child, say, so-and-so, go get this and give it to. Get this and give it to. So, you know, your older one who's working on language and social skills can accept it and put it on top, and your younger one's learning to follow some directions. So use all kinds of things that you can do with.
Another strategy you just modeled was ready, set, and
yep.
Pausing mm-hmm. and having the child filling go.
Mm-hmm. Or 1, 2. Or sometimes, if I know a kid's already got ready, set, go, you know, we'll make up something else. Perfect. Yeah. And that kind of pause you can use with everything. Here's your kid with a Play-Doh bag. You say, I need, hopefully that, you know, help. So I need, or you need, you know, help. So pausing to give them that opportunity. And if you also have a student, a kid who's working on just that, you know, the eye contact and all those kinds of things, you know, I'm going to do this. So you look that way. You need help. So getting that turning around and looking at you opportunities as well. So this is one of the other essential speech therapist toys. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Pop-Up Pirate. I think every one of your students has worked with Papa Pirate with me. So the pirate goes in the middle, and see how long it's taking Miss Mary to put it together, because what are we working on right now? Waiting. Wait, 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 where does the pirate go? In the middle. And the idea, lots of different, look, we have different color swords. With the older students, sometimes I'll give one the bag, and everybody else has to request to that one what color they want. Or the one who has the bag is going to decide who gets what color. Older students as well, directions. Miss Mary forgot how to play Pop-Up Pirate. What are we supposed to do? What do we do with these? So you see how I'm not answering my questions. I'm not giving them any information. They're having to give me that information. students who are working, kids who are working on just language and just like a pre-word or single word, two word. You know, you might have one here and one here, and this is my student, and this is me, and it'll be like it's Mary's turn. We're gonna put it in, and there you saw what it does. How did that happen? Usually it's not the first one. But you can work on turn taking, and when then that thing pops up, everybody is happy. We could probably do this one for 2 hours a day. Because when I play it with multiple students, everybody wants the turn to make it pop. And the nice thing about that is if it didn't pop this time, what, you know, they've all learned to say, it might pop next time. So lots of different kinds of things that you can do this. But turn taking, colors, just requesting, figuring out how to tell Miss Mary how to play the game because she's forgotten. So lots of different things that can be done with this. And then, you know, there's always cleanup. But once again, you'll see my plastic bag that I have in here. So this is not the best one. Most of them can get this one open. And not to mention the fact that when I do work with your kids, so when they come in and they want to do Pop-Up Pirate, that's what they're given. I'm not going to take it out. I want them to just go through all of those steps, because going through all those steps physically helps them remember, helps them think about words that they can use. So with some of my students who don't have a lot of language, this is the other things that we can use, or I can help them. This is a lot for a preschooler, but most of the time, you know, I'm modeling and then I'm physically helping them through that. And I use these kinds of things with children who don't have a lot of language, and sometimes I use these kinds of things with students who do have a lot of language. The reason being is it just helps them keep organized, all right, and helps them keep, you know, helps them wait a little bit longer because there's a my turn and a your turn on here. Yeah, a lot of pre-literacy because you'll see the words are on there. So the other thing that I kind of wanted to talk to you a little about is books. So my mom was a school librarian in Alexandria, so I grew up with a school librarian, so books was always something that we had a lot of. And this is definitely something that you can do at home. I try and adapt a lot of the books here for our kids. So you can see just these little pictures. This one's a little bit, you know, higher level, but, you know, we're going on a leaf hunt, and I'm sure you guys have all heard about that, the story, we're going on a leaf hunt. I don't know if you have, but it's really cute. But there's all different kinds of ways to adapt preposition concepts here. So I'll read it. Now, when I read a book to it, I look at the level. Your kids are all a little bit younger, so I'm not going to read every single word in this story because that's just not going to work. So I might say something like, oh, we're coming to a mountain. It's a tall mountain. We can't go under it. We got to go over it. Up, 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 up. And then I'll take these pictures off as we read it. For the younger ones, I may not use these prepositional concepts yet because they're not, maybe under but not over. It's a little bit harder. I'll take these pictures off as I read it, and we'll put it out. And then when I go back and read it again, we're going to try to figure out which picture goes on which page. Some of your children, I pre-teach this too. That means I'm going to go and take them in my room, maybe one or two at a time, and we're going to read the story together. And then we're going to go and we're going to do it in their classroom. So that multiple exposure gives them that opportunity to learn the language, to wait a little bit in a smaller group, and then practice those skills in a bigger group. But this is definitely something that you can do at home to augment some of your picture books if you want to. You know, having them just match, just that concept. Which one goes, you know, climb, we're looking for climbing, where's climbing? So that receptive language too, where's climbing? And you might just have two pictures out, where's climbing? Climbing goes here, and they're looking and find the picture of someone climbing and put it here. So this is a website that we have access to. It's called Lesson Picks. It's actually not that, it's only $36 a year. It's called Lesson Picks. I use this for probably everything from articulation, homework pages, to making visuals for all of those visuals you see behind you with the stop. Those big ones right there, those are all made with Lesson Picks. The other thing that you can do is you can take pictures of all of your own things at home and just run them off. Laminate them, get contact paper, Velcro, which is too bad I hadn't thought of that concept of Velcro, because it's what we use so much of.
You can also buy two books.
Yeah, and cut one up.
Plastic, mm-hmm. Cut one up.
Mm-hmm. And it doesn't, you know, I mean, you can go to the dollar store and buy two little books of the same at the dollar store and cut them up. It's because really what you're working on is that language and that turn-taking and the waiting. So those are fun things that you can do with your own books. This is a big book that we have here. So they love the big books. They think they're the best things in the world, just because they're big. You can see this one here where I actually put the picture here, so they had to just match. But once again, this is a night, even though it's a big book, look, make a plan. Now I'm going to say, you know, what I did was said, draw a picture, because that's what they're going to understand better than make a plan. And then we read this book, but there's all kinds of, and this was, everyone loved this one because it was tools and hammers and making walls. And what the OT and I did with this book was we read it, and then we had some of the older kids take those blocks and build a wall. We had a group. We had kids drawing a house. So there's all kinds of extension activities that you can do, and rainy day kinds of activities that you can do with things. This is definitely, I think I actually did this one with the young classes because it's a wordless book. And this is actually part of the creative curriculum that we have here at JTP, but this is a wordless book. So it doesn't really matter what you say for the book. There aren't any words. For the older kids, I said, hey, what's really weird about this? Look at these pages. And they finally figured out there wasn't any words on. There were no letters. There's no letters. What happened to the letters? So just, you know, this helps you as a parent. You know, you've got a child who doesn't have a whole lot of language skills. You might just say something like, oh, red block. Turn the page and say, oh, uh-oh, fire. Just small things like that. If you have an older student, you might say, what are they doing? Oh my goodness, look at that. What should they do? And then, to take it a step further, because I don't know where we found these, but they're almost the same, we built little houses. And what happens is they build a fire truck. So we tried to build a fire truck. And then later on, they build a train. So we tried to build a train. So just extending all of that out. The wordless books are really good because for older students, they have to figure out, you know, how are they going to tell that story. And once again, if you have an older child at home, they can read that story to their younger sibling, which is really nice. And I wanted to bring this one in because I just actually used this. So this, I think almost everybody in the school is doing insects right now, I think. So, now, these are Lakeshore, but you can make your own. So, we're all doing insects. So, we read in the tall, tall grass, and then we went through the grass to find the bugs. This is what fancy therapists call a sensory box. So, if you guys have ever heard about sensory boxes, this is a sensory box. You can fill it. Macaroni. You can actually put cooked macaroni. I have done that before. Macaroni, dried macaroni, rice, beans, the package, the little snow packy stuffing things that you get when you send a package, the glass beads, Legos, anything you want. This is holiday grass, that's what we'll call it. I have it in green for grass, and I have it in blue for water. Rice, the little styrofoam white things I put in, I just took them out because that was the snow. And then at Target, they always sell these great little erasers, and I found ones that were penguins and snowmen, and that's what we did. So those kinds of things are great. You know, you're digging, you're finding something. Oh my goodness, who doesn't want to find a beetle in the grass? So let me show you too what I did with this book, because sometimes you have books that you really love, but they're just really long. So for the young kids, because I did this with both of your classes Tuesday, I just paper clipped. I didn't want to do the other two pages, so I just paper clipped them. And then I just did the ones I wanted. Now granted, your kids aren't going through my books. So, you know, that's why, you know, it's a little bit harder at home. But if you do have some favorite books that you really know that your kids love, I would put them up, put them away. And then you can take pictures of the covers and put them on a piece of paper and say, which book do you want to read today? And they're going to pull that picture off and give it to you. It's okay not to have everything out at your house. If you go back and look in my room, you'll see I don't have anything out. Everything is put away so that they have to use those communication temptations to figure it out.
When you're doing like the cards and stuff, like if you put them away, do you put the cards in like a book, or do you put the cards in a place that you find it? I'm just trying to figure out how to operationalize.
Yep. So let me, so I have several things, and I just brought one in. I think it's actually like a jewelry holder. It's like, it's a big rectangle thing that has pockets in it. So I have a lot of pictures in there, like a lot of these pictures of different objects in there. And when I first introduced this with a child, I may only put out two pictures. But I will tell you this, it takes them maybe a month to figure out that that thing is full of all of Mary's pictures, and they'll go over and scan it, and then they'll pull out the one they want. I also label bins, you know, and put things in bins and label them. It is a kind of a guessing game as to where your child is at the time. Sometimes I just start out with one picture, and I give them, you know, one, the picture is there. It's like the two favorite things I know they want. So there's the one, and it's generally the bubbles. I probably go through 25 bubble pictures a year. So it's the bubble pictures on the table. They'll pick it up, and then we'll walk over, and I might have the bubble and, let's see, a stapler, because they don't want a stapler. A bubble and a stapler here, and they're going to go for that bubble. And then eventually the idea would be to put a bubble and maybe a less preferred, and then a bubble and another thing they like too. And they have to try to match up that bubble.
So if they're working with you, presumably they would conceptually get the pictures. Like, wouldn't it transfer at home or no?
Not necessarily. Okay. Not necessarily. Some kids, that transfer is really what the hard part is. So I started out with, can they match that picture to the item? And a lot of times I had to just teach that. Yeah, over and over again. But that's something that you can email me about.
Shutterfly does magnets, and they do a 4-pack of small magnets. And if you get them on a sale, which they have all the time, you get that 4-pack for like $6. And so you can get them printed with whatever photographs. I haven't gotten them yet, so I'll let you know how they go. But I just ordered like 20 little magnet photos.
That's great.
I love my French.
Good.
My son loves my French. She's always over there.
That's great. It's a great idea. Makes it, yeah. I think for any kids, it just helps with organization to do that.
And with your older kids, if you're using the actual word, then you're doing some pre-literacy stuff with them as well. And some of my kids, I have had children who actually can read like the letters better, like the word better than they like the picture. But I still always pair them together. And there's some students that I have that are reading, so I might take that word off because I want to see if they can actually just match it visually by looking at the picture. That was actually what I was going to touch on real quick. So articulation, I mean, any of these things you can use with articulation. So if you have a child that's working on the p sound, Mr. Potato Head, b sound, bubbles, k, car, all right? So you can use any. And if you don't, if you're trying to figure out how does this work, you know, you might have to do some brainstorming in terms of what you're doing. Like pop-up pirate, great for P's. Because you got P at the beginning of the words, you got P in the middle if you'd say pop up, and you got it at the end for up. So you just kind of.
So do you go like pop, pop, pop? Like do you like start with the sound and then have them say it? Or like?
So when I'm working on articulation, even with the little ones, we actually look at the letter. Because it's just that's a pre-literacy. So we'll look at the letter. Oh, see that? That's a P. I don't expect them to tell me it's a P. And then look, it makes this pop, 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 pop. Lots of mirror things, lots of watch. That's why waiting and look and watch are things to work on with small children. So you got blocks, b. I'm thinking of those early developing sounds, which are P, B, and M, T, D, and N, K, and G. Those are the ones that that develop first. So a lot of these, Play-Doh. You got Play-Doh, and you got cut, even though it's a roller. You know, right now we're going to say cut because that's what it is. And phone, F is a really hard sound for a lot of kids to make. So there you've got. And I tell children, put your lips together. I mean, I tell children who you think they don't understand what you're saying, put your lips together, pa, pa, pa. Or you know, feel k, k, k. So those are the kinds of words that I use when I'm talking about articulation. Articulation is something that is, there is a real, well, there's a developmental sequence to language and there's a developmental sequence to articulation. If your child is not producing R, do not worry about it. R does not sometimes come till 8 or 9 years of age. S is Z's, some things like that.
If it hasn't come by, I'm like unrelated to a child here, if it hasn't come by like 10.
For an R?
Yeah.
Yeah, I probably would be thinking about it. Hardest sound in the word world is R. I had R's and S's and Z's. So was I. Same one. Yeah, maybe that's why I do what I do. But I have to tell you, I mean, I get to play all day long. It is so much fun. I get to play all day long. And I, this is my passion. Oh, I'm crying, but this is my passion, so I really love it. It's a great thing. And I love your kids. They're fun. So do you have any other questions?
This is Mary's email.
Yeah.
If you guys don't have it, I think most of you do. But
please, when you go home and if you're looking at something going, you know, this is something that he or she really likes to do, but I just don't know like what to do with it, please email me. Chances are I've probably used it or seen it. Or wanting to buy it, so I'm happy to help you out with that. Because you and I also wanted to let you guys know too that, I mean, fun is the best thing. And I know it's stressful to think, oh, you know, the future, but fun is the best thing to have. And you know how your child has fun. Outside, I didn't even talk about outside. We could talk about outside forever, but fun is the best way to do it. And those things that you know are really fun, take a look at and see how you can work on expanding those language skills and work on articulation and those kinds of things as well. But that's the best way to think, you know. We have such fun with this, what can I do? But I'm happy to help you if you have some very specific items that you're thinking about. Anybody else have any questions? But please feel free to email me. I can't guarantee you I'll get back within 12 hours, but hopefully 24. And if you have something that you have found that is a really neat item that you have gotten a lot of language and information and play with your kids, please let me know, because I'm always looking for things that might entice communication. All right?
Thank you so much.
Oh, no problem.
Really appreciate it. Thank you.
This is great. Thank you.